Good evening, everybody. Elizabeth Diamond, co-founder of Diamonds Forever Diamonds Network. Welcome, everybody. Welcome, welcome. I'm glad you're here on the second day of Equinox, March 20th, 21st. Cynthia will talk more about that tonight. I might have got that wrong, but it's somewhere close to that. And today is March 21st, 2016. So welcome, everybody. So tonight, we're going to pray the law of one. It's more than a prayer.
Are you looking for healing or a change in your life to help you enjoy it more fully? You might benefit from a galactic energy reading and clearing from Chris Jacobs. Chris will work with you on a soul level to clear unseen negative influences, implants, programs, contracts, and energetic blocks. Chris Jacobs is a gifted energy healer. Contact him today at ChristopherStephenJacobs@gmail.com.
We are the tools. We are technology. We are the creators of our imagination with our intent, with our art, poetry, what we create. I do know these 2 days are creative mode. Be in your creative mode, you guys. So, and also galactizing with our brothers and sisters. I'm sure they're creating. Maybe we'll ask them what they've been creating lately tonight. Goes with the theme. So, welcome everybody, and we're going to get started with the law of one, which is very important in your life, whether you know it or not, but if you stay around, you'll learn, and you'll know that you know that you know. You'll have so much faith in your heart. You'll walk around confident of the creator you are regarding if you breathe in some of this Diamonds Network energy. So, I'll come in later. I have some things to bring, and Candy Jar, Candy will bring in her news after Cynthia. The lineup tonight, we will pray the law of one, and Misty is going to read one of her tarot cards, and that will be aimed toward the whole audience, what we exactly need tonight, and because she asks, ask and you shall receive, right? We are all working together, even our galactic brothers and sisters and others in other realms, even if you can't see them. You have to have faith. Faith, and you'll see someday. It'll be more and more tangible. It's a process for all of us. And after that, bring some in, Candy Jar, and then Chris will be galactizing. So, onward. And Cynthia, would you come in and lead us in the Law of One? And then let me know when to unlock the audience so we can repeat the Law of One after you.
Gotcha. Thanks. Now, this is a prenumbral eclipse. It's coming up Wednesday morning about 8 o'clock on Eastern Time. And it's a very powerful time with a lot of major planetary configurations. Of course, we say that every time, and it's always true. But anyway, there's this huge power being unleashed to address the orphans and the exiles on the planet in all kingdoms with fantastic vision, And that's what I would like to emphasize with our law of one tonight. excuse me, got a little frog in my throat. That we visualize fantastic miracles, especially concerning the unfortunates on the planet, those who are the most at risk, actually. So it can be the animal kingdoms, the species that are hanging on. It can be humans. It can be any sentient being that is orphaned and exiled for any reason. It can be someone who may have all their siblings and may be living in riches, but they may be exiled emotionally. They may be orphaned emotionally, even in their own family. So the orphans and the exiles of the world, some of them are very obvious, and some of them hide behind the most amazing facades. But the orphans and the exiles in this world, it's exactly within 1 minute of squaring Jupiter. And Jupiter is at the place of fantastic vision. So we are being asked, while we're saying the Law of One tonight, to have fantastic visions of amazing turnarounds. You know, we've heard of Moses making the Red Sea part, you know, go apart so he could get his people through. You know, we hear of Ezekiel and the wheels of fire. We hear, you know, of the blind seeing, the lame walking, the loaves and the fishes. And those are fantastic visions. And that's what we're being asked to come up with now as a collective, is fantastic visions of just healing. The orphans and the exiles on this planet. So I'm going to say the Law of One sentence by sentence. Oh, and just, you know, as a footnote, inside of each one of us, no matter how happy and well-adjusted we may be, there are parts of ourselves that are orphaned and exiled. There may be people living in very conservative families or towns where their wild artistic side has been exiled, banished, and they're longing to explore that part of themselves. There are places in the world where sexuality has been made very dangerous. And so people's sexual sides have been orphaned or exiled, you know, to the outer fringes of their consciousness. There are people out there with amazing genius and talents who have been forced to conform so strictly to certain ways of being and doing that their genius and their unique excellence has been exiled. So when we're talking orphans and exiles, we're talking those parts of ourselves that may be orphaned and exiled as well. And those parts of our friends and relatives and acquaintances that may be orphaned and exiled as well. So we are asking for fantastic visions.
Cynthia?
Yeah.
So what I want you guys and all of us to do, while we are repeating the Law of One after Cynthia, imagine and intend to heal the orphans and exiles, which is us too. You just heard Cynthia say that. First, imagine and intend the healing for the orphans and exiles physically, then go to mentally, then go to spiritually, then go to emotionally. And just go through those four, imagining how you will intend for healing for the orphans and exiles, and that includes us. Start with emotions. Emotions is important in the humanity.
Oh, yeah.
Emotions, physical, mental, spiritual, okay?
Right.
Beautiful. And the room is unlocked, so just star 6 when Cynthia is ready to say the prayer, guys.
Yeah, and I also want to add, you know, I'll say a line and y'all say a line, and then I'll say another line and y'all say another line. But if at the end one or the other of you feels inspired to bring through a fantastic vision, do it. Share it with
me. Yes.
I mean, me and Mare and, you know, Candy and Lily and all of us here, Chris and all of us, we're just humble servants. We're all here together to dance this dream awake. And your vision, don't hold it back. See, that's another situation I was just talking about. It could be that you are a quiet, shy person, who never takes center stage, and you have orphaned and exiled that splendid part of your magical child self from not speaking up, in which case, what a healing for yourself if you speak up and share your fantastic vision. Ta-da. I just had to throw that in there. Okay, so is everybody ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here goes. We are addressing everything in creation. We are addressing everything physical, emotional, mental, and spiritual in creation, known or unknown, seen or unseen, understood or not understood, in this or any timeline or quantum possibility, to come and be with us now and to join us as we say the law of one. Here is the first line. We are all one. Open the lines.
We are all one.
We are all one.
When one is harmed, all are harmed.
When one is harmed, all are harmed.
Therefore, in the name of who I am.
Therefore, in the name of who I am.
And I am one with all there is.
I am one with all there is.
I ask that only the highest good of all concerned.
Happens.
And I give thanks that this is done. So be it.
Thank you. Namaste. So anybody with the vision, come in and share. Just star 6.
I would like to add another few orphans and exiles, and that is there are entities who have been orphaned and exiled in the magical realms, the realms of the gnomes or the undines or the salamanders or the sylphs. These are very real powers and entities. And it could be that some of them were captured by dark magicians hundreds of years ago and, you know, cast out, exiled, orphaned. And the thing about God is the Supreme Being, which is omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient, is God loves everything equally. In the Bible it says God's love is like the sun. It shines equally on the good and bad alike. And since when we are in our depth of stillness within, when in between lifetimes and in deep dreamless sleep and when we were infants, we experience ourselves as one with God. And that part of us is what keeps us alive, and that has been proven absolutely. That they did it in sleep labs. They hooked up people to these biofeedback machines, and every time anybody went into the deep delta brainwave state, they'd wake them up to see what would happen. And in 10 days, they started to die. And they found that it's in the deep delta brainwave state that our bodies heal. And if you wake up somebody in the deep delta brainwave state, it's a dreamless sleep. It's called deep dreamless sleep. But what they found is they're in a state of just pure being and oneness with all there is. And so that part exists in you and me, or we wouldn't be alive, and it exists in everything, or it wouldn't exist. And that part of us loves everything unconditionally because it experiences itself as one with everything. So whatever has been exiled or orphaned, physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually, whether it's whole people or parts of people or parts of reality or beings, you know, on this or any planet or any plane, the very fact that they exist means that they are part of the One. And love is the appropriate response. For example, if a huge, powerful demon materialized in your bedroom one night, you know, with horrible smells and screeches and the whole nine yards, you know, would you react with love? And if so, would you remember to do the law of one with it? Because what we're doing is we're reprogramming all these powers and forces that have been used for kings and queens and magicians and wars and occult societies. We're reprogramming all of them. These are very real entities and beings. They're powers. They're principalities. They're dominions. They're thrones. And, you know, some have been beautiful and good all along, and others have been captured and used for various purposes. And some of them have been exiled and orphaned. And so we, with this eclipse.
Cynthia?
Yeah.
You reprogrammer, you. Oh, I must be a reprogrammer, too. I said a law of one. Oh, whoever says a law of one must be a reprogrammer. Well, welcome, reprogrammer.
Well, that's exactly the whole case.
Uh-huh, exactly the whole case.
Reprogrammers
Yay.
Are us.
Absolutely. Hey, let's do Misty's card to all of us.
Okay,
Carol
let's
card.
Do.
5 or 10 minutes, and then you're back up. And Misty? Let Cynthia
yeah.
pick the number.
That sounds like a great idea.
How about 7?
Ooh, okay.
That's love.
Thanks. 2, 5, 6, 7. Oh, my. It happens to be well. Okay. This is Earth Element Pentacles, and it's the number 10, well. So give me 1 second to find that in my book. I was expecting love, I have to tell you.
What's it sound like? What's it stand for?
It's Earth Element Pentacles. It's wealth is the card.
Wealth, W-E-A-L-T-H?
That's correct.
Okay, and everybody, I know our tendency, wealth is the first thought to go to money. But remember, and Cynthia, I learned this from Cynthia. Anyway, love you, Cynthia. Wealth.
Yes.
The wealth is you, guys. The wealth in your spirituality, wealth in your emotions, the wealth in your physicality, and the wealth in your, mental. So think of that, too, you guys. Add that. Expand your horizons. Expand your consciousness. After all, let's use that 5D expanding consciousness energy, right? Okay, go for it.
Okay. The traditional card is the Ten of Pentacles. The key words are abundance, gain, family, strength, and home. And this is a beautiful card. The description is symbol of the rising regenerated sun. A magical phoenix woman rises out of the earth. Legend says that out of the dead phoenix, a worm crawls from which the new phoenix grows. A single standing stone, earth element, decorated with spirals, rests in front of the beautiful shapeshifter. The flowing spiral decoration mirrors the flow of universal energy and the DNA helix. The roots of the tree echo the spirals carved in stone, weaving the wealth card together as one. Next to the stone grows an ancient apple tree laden with golden fruit. The tree grows as if out of the body, ashes, of the phoenix. The exotic half-woman, half-magical creature is feasting on the apples. The sacred tree of Avalon, the other world. Apples are the food of the gods. In Welsh mythology, The consort is given 3 golden apples to eat by the goddess Rhiannon. Every year thereafter, he lives 3 months in the other world and 9 months in the ordinary world. 3 gray cranes fly south with a small bowl in one of their beaks. The 3 cranes represent the threefold, life, death, and rebirth. Maiden, mother, and crone. Son, father, and grandfather, and positive, negative, and neutral. With them, in a small bowl, they carry the blood of Tarvos, the bull, the golden one, symbol of the sun, so that the sun will be ever reborn. Okay. The prophecy of this card is, by gaining rapport with the earth element, you bring prosperity and wealth into your life. This card may represent a time for investing in property, a house, or starting a new business. Through communication and organization, it becomes the optimum time to manifest abundance into your life. Material prosperity, lineage, and family honor, as well as good investments, gain, riches, or inheritance may come to the seeker in the near future. You may seek to improve your home environment because wealth is a card of healing and inspiration at home. It didn't really say much about money. So.
Oh, that was beautiful, Misty. That was great. Awesome.
You're
Thank
welcome.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. Thank you, Cynthia. And thank you, Elizabeth.
Yeah. Cynthia, come on back. That was awesome.
Yeah, I appreciate that a lot. The money thing is big right now on the planet. And I think people are beginning to realize that true wealth, you know, comes from deep satisfaction. Especially when it's at the as above, so below, when they can have satisfaction on every level, and including the earth element. For example, last week I was in deep meditation, and I realized how much this place is my home.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, I let it in. I accepted it, that this is my home and that I love it here. With all its imperfections, you know, it's still my home. And that earth element grounded me. It anchored me like planting a tree. And I have enough faith in miracles to believe that, you know, I'm nourished and protected, and that my home and my groundedness to the earth is blessed, and that the highest good of all concern will happen. And then, of course, I ask that all beings have a wonderful home, that all beings, you know, be able to find a place on the planet where they can ground and just sink into the love of the earth element, be totally nourished by the energies coming from the earth for them in that place. And I look forward to the time, and I think it's coming sooner rather than later, when people don't have to leave home. They don't have to leave home. They'll have their work there. They'll have their play there. They'll have, you know, everything there that they need. They don't have to leave home. They can leave home if they want to leave home for various purposes, according to guidance, but they don't have to leave home. Because I think that's one of the saddest things that can ever happen, is for a person to lose their sense of home. And, you know, being an orphan or being an exile, you've lost that sense. And so I'm asking to see, I am asking with all these people from other planets and all these masters and saints and all this enlightenment that's happening. I am asking for a fantastic vision of everybody being in supreme happiness and having their physical home. If somebody likes to travel, then they can have a traveling home, maybe a spaceship or, you know, a RV, whatever, boat. But home nonetheless, a place that they feel is theirs, and the earth element surrounds them with a protective love. And then I want to expand that to the sense of home, of being a place where you are absolutely loved and where you absolutely love in return. Whether it's with your pets or your plants or the earth itself and the trees and the spirits, or whether it's your neighbors or your family or your children or your friends, but that sense of home and belonging and being with people you want to be with that uplift you, that are uplifted by you. So there's the joy of feeling important and the joy of being blessed by those around us that are important to us. And then I want to expand that even further to a fantastic vision of amazing mental clarity. For example, in this prenumbral eclipse, Mercury is within 1 degree of the sun. Mercury is in the place of love, magic, and the sun is at the place of strengthening love. And the rising sign for this eclipse is authority. In other words, the mystical path that we should each take for this eclipse is authority. In other words, go into your God self and absolutely claim authority over everything. Now, if that's not a fantastic vision, I don't know what is. And that may seem like the most fantastic thing you could ever do, but I'll tell you what, if you think about it and you understand the principles involved, nothing else and nothing less will do. Each and every one of us has got to take full authority in our divine I am essence and come up with our own fantastic visions of every single being being happy. You know, the Bible is really big on that. It talks about how the great rejoicing when the shepherd finds the lost sheep. It says it's not God's will that any should be lost. And so it's just something about this eclipse coming up right here at the equinox where the orphans and the exiles are demanding to be healed. And so, and Jupiter is squaring it within 1 minute at the place of fantastic vision. So the homework assignment for everybody on the call, I would like to suggest, if it feels right for you to do it, is sit down in meditation at some point and think of the most fantastic vision you can of healing the orphans and the exiles, whoever they may be, whatever it may be, however it may be. And when you do that, in fact, you can do it right now because some people are busy and they may not think about it. Just come up with a vision, a fantastic vision. Maybe the ET's landing and, you know, all the orphans and exiles having been identified previously and they're all miraculously healed and given a place to live and blah, blah, blah. That's a fantastic vision. Or maybe it's the angels from heaven sending frequencies so that everybody is just struck with enlightenment. And the orphans and the exiles go into rapture and bliss. That's a fantastic vision.
Cynthia?
Yeah.
I would like to add something to that vision for people who do it.
Do it.
Who choose to do it. If you can hold that vision for at least 67 seconds, don't get distracted by how it can't happen or whatnot, but when you get to that vision and you hold it for at least 67 seconds, you're really doing something really powerful.
And that's mastery over your attention, and that's the biggie in martial arts. All of them, Qigong, everything is mastery over attention. So the more you can practice holding a focus like that, the better. So, yeah, thanks.
Don't let any negativity try to tear it down, because the vision is what's important. And also the prayer for other people, I just want to say, I know that that is the most powerful thing that anybody can do for anybody. So with people who may be in positions where they have friends or they have people they want to help but can't, kind of like me, I pray for them. Pray for them. Set a good intention for them. And that is truly the most powerful thing that you can do. So.
And get a fantastic vision. Okay, so here's step number two. Is hopefully you did get a fantastic vision. Hopefully, in fact, if you want to, we can be quiet for a minute while you cook up a fantastic vision. Now, you're cooking up a vision, a fantastic vision of the orphans and the exiles on the planet, and even off planet for that matter, but especially on the planet during this eclipse, having miraculous love miracles. But as you get this vision, as it begins to form through inner guidance, I am asking you to make it even more beautiful. So get your vision, and as it comes in, do it with the intention that as you get it, that you're making it even more beautiful. So for the next 60 seconds, 60 to 90 seconds, everybody get a fantastic vision. Now, if you are an exile, if your family has exiled you, you're the black sheep of the family, then that vision's going to include you. Or if you know some member of the family who's exiled for any reason, get a fantastic vision of everything just being made okay, miraculously. Because the sun is at the place of strengthening love. And Mercury's at the place of love miracles. Are conjunct. And the earth and the moon are at the place of fertility, of love. So let's get a fantastic vision of ourselves and all beings, the animals, plants, anything that's been exiled or orphaned, having fantastic love miracles, the most fantastic love miracles you could ever imagine in a zillion years. Just imagine it. Get a visual image. Ah. And as you make this image, just keep making it more beautiful. No matter how beautiful your image is, make it even more beautiful. More emotionally beautiful, physically beautiful, mentally and spiritually beautiful. Make it so beautiful that your heart breaks with the beauty of it. All these beings being loved, being welcomed home, being safe, healing, opening up. Experiencing self-worth and self-esteem, safety, beauty, Now, while y'all are doing that, I'll just ramble on here in the background.
Cynthia?
South, what?
I'm imagining it's a great big heart above the earth, and in the heart energy is the law of one, highest good of all, concerned with the love, healing energy. And now all kinds of little sparks are coming out of the heart. And little men on parachutes, that they're not men. They're beings made out of the words, the law of one.
Oh.
They have a bouquet of flowers and a box of candy in one hand. This represents what we're doing, the love, healing.
This is beautiful.
And,
So
now they're all landing on everybody's shoulders on Earth and all over the Earth, everything living on the Earth.
Oh, that's beautiful.
And that heart now goes up, shoots up over the universe and raining down the same thing all over every living thing.
Now
and
give it
shoots up again,
power.
And it shoots up again, and now we're in multiverses, and it's raining down.
Cynthia.
Yes.
I'm actually probably one of those people that you described has been orphaned. I've been away from my entire family most of my life.
Wow.
And it's so nice that you have this prayer. I receive your good intention. And it's so interesting, Elizabeth, that you described this, because I saw those lights coming down to me. My vision was I was receiving that light. I was envisioning having, you know, new family around me, new people, and, you know, a community that is family to me. And I've created that community around me here. However, it's still different. It's not my biological family, right? They're still far away. And so what you described, I was seeing, Elizabeth. You were seeing that light coming down, and I was seeing this shining light on me. And it's great. It's beautiful. You really are one. Thank you.
Just take that in. Take it all in. Take your time and just let yourself fully surrender to it. Let it permeate every cell.
Thank you.
Does anyone else have a vision they would like to share out loud?
This is Misty. I was just envisioning white light going across the planet and cleansing and healing anything, anyone, any negative, anything, hurt, pain, healing to everybody.
And we ask that this be done according to the highest good of all concerned.
Always.
And so it is. See, this is authority. Take your visions and ask that it be done according to the highest good of all concerned. And if you do this, what I'm suggesting, what we're doing now, you will be activating this chart. Absolutely. Now, this is going to sound totally off topic and weird, but it isn't. It's part of the chart. I suggest you eat well. I suggest that those of you who are eating food that you don't think is very healthy for you, that during this time approaching and during and shortly after this full moon on Wednesday morning, that you be very aware of your food and to bless it. To bless every molecule of it and bless how it's going to affect your body. Because in this chart, the gateway to higher realms is really, believe it or not, I know this sounds bizarre, but it's through food. You might want to go on a fruit fast. You might want to fix something special. There's this huge emphasis on healing the past. We have the South Node exactly conjunct Ceres, which again is a type of food, and Chiron to the exact degree. This is highly unusual. And the South Node is our past. So we're going to be healing our past. Now, this thing of healing the past has been a big deal in the last few eclipses. Back, if you back overlooking the months, and we were warned about this. And so if you can eat whatever you want to eat, I mean, it can be an apple, it can be a feast, it can be anything. It can be a box of old moldy crackers, for that matter, but whatever it is you eat, use it as a gateway to higher dimensions, to higher levels. For example, since there's no two of us alike, we'll all do our little thing differently, but one possible suggestion is you want to combine the fantastic vision with this. And if you can imagine, say, a fantastic vision of all food on the planet magically being perfect for whoever's eating it, that includes the fishes in the sea, that no matter how many pollutants and radioactivity and sonar, that whatever they're eating just magically heals them of everything. And even if it's the worst GMO and chemicals and this and that, that a fantastic vision of rays coming from the central sun transmuting everything on the planet, including the food, on an ongoing basis to being life-giving physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. Now, that's a fantastic vision. So if you can combine your fantastic visioning for the orphans and the exiles with miraculous food miracles, because we can change the DNA in all those plants that have been genetically modified. We can change the waters. Dr. Emoto proved that. We can change everything through our consciousness. And so this is only Monday. We've got all this evening. We've got all day tomorrow to come up with these fantastic visions. And whatever fantastic visions I come up with or you come up with, do it also for everyone else. Imagine everyone's hearts blooming with joy and creativity and bliss and peace. I guess I've done my part, Liz.
Well, thank you, Cynthia. Thank you, Cynthia. That was just fantastic.
Yay!
Yay!
Yeah. I love you guys so much.
Absolutely. I hear Candy's here too. We're gonna
Yay,
go.
Yay, Candy! I love you too. Here's a hug.
I have a few things I'm going to bring in first, and then we'll bring Candy Shop Candy News on, too. Okay, thanks. Thanks, you guys. Fantastic. Well, this just to add to what Cynthia said with the astrology. And hi, Diamonds. I changed a little bit to Diamonds to all you. Hi, Diamonds. You probably know the spring equinox is the beginning of the new astrological year. This year it begins at 4:30 a.m. on the 20th of March. On this day, the sun will be in perfect equilibrium as it travels through the tropical zodiac and enters the Ram, the first degree of Aries. For the first time since the fall equinox, the hours of light are longer than the hours of darkness. The spring equinox marks a time of beginnings and new life, of new growth, of sowing and childbirth. And for those of us who are older, it involves regrowth, renewal, a revigorated flourishing of mind and body. And just as plants and animals store energy to see them through the winter, so do we humans. Just as plants and animals release their stored energy in buds and blossoms, fruit and new growth, shedding their winter coats to frolic and cavort short, sleek, glossy summer coats, so too, we humans need to release our stored energy back into the cosmos. Unfortunately, all too often, we fail to live in harmony with the universe. And to live in, let me add here, to live in harmony is that, Cynthia, yeah, let's have fantastic visions with our fantastic healing to the world as we do it now and through tomorrow. Rather than using the weight we gain during the holiday season as energy to fuel our lives and creativity, we hoard it. Yes, fat is quite literally energy. Your body gains it as a reserve for you to use. And so your body and soul have a deep cosmic need for you to release it back into the universe for reuse. Because one of the fundamental laws of the universe is that energy is never lost, only transformed. So that's what we're going to do. Transform our stored up energy through the winter, you guys, and use it in fantastic healing visions, like Cynthia said. Denied transformation, the growing weight of the unused stored energy becomes a toxic burden that thwarts your ability to accomplish your life goals in both work and love, forcing you to live in disharmony with the cosmos. Tomorrow I'm going to introduce you to someone very special. Okay. All right, that's it. That was that short add-on for Cynthia. And now I just want to let you know I'll be blogging Benjamin Fulford report. It unfortunately is not up today. I just checked. His March 15th report is still on there. So we won't be doing that. Look for the Diamonds blog, Diamonds with an S Forever, 31.blogspot.com. I did a blog yesterday. It was very good. And I just want to do my last thing. I want to do can you still hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, we can still hear you. Yep.
Thanks. I just want to give my thank yous and shout outs to the ones that we use their, I'll just say their network to let the world know regarding Diamonds shows and Diamonds network. you know, Facebook, YouTube, IQDcalls.com, and AshtarCommand.com. Also, TSU.co. That's a new social network. And it used to be where you have to sign up through somebody else. Well, they're growing. They're growing and flourishing and budding. They are now, you can sign up on TSU.co just by yourself. You won't need anybody's link to sign up through. My link's on the right-hand side of the blog if you want to. I don't know if you can or not, but just go on over there and join it. There's lots of beauty. There's lots of different tags of what you're interested in, community or politics news or food or help. So check it out. So thank you, TSU, and all of you guys. I want to thank the ones that upload the Diamond Shows. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I want to thank all of you who listen in to the live shows and the YouTube videos and all around the world. I want to thank all of our galactic brothers and sisters that listen in and join in every Monday and more than Mondays on the Diamonds Network. Thank you for that. I want to thank all of our financial benefactors that have faithfully gave a benefact energy back in kind every month. And please, we still, even though I don't announce it every time, we still need benefactors, either monthly benefactors or when you can, financial ones, or if you have a lot of money. This Diamonds Network is great energy to invest in. You go to the donate button on the right-hand side of the blog for that. I want to thank the faithful ones that have, through these last couple, 2 or 3 years, and this last couple, 2 or 3 or 4 months. Thank you, guys. I want to thank the benefactors that are benefactoring with Diamonds Network. I've intended this and I've called for it, like Ted Winslow and his wife, his healing activation music. And you guys, right now, you can help out the Diamonds Network as a benefactor if you go purchase one of his healing activation sounds. It's great. The albums are only, albums are $12.99, and you get 30% off of that. And plus a portion goes to Diamonds Network. So that link is on the right-hand side of the blog. I want to thank, we have a lot of benefactors coming, you guys. I want to thank those who have taken their own shows that they've done through the years and joined here with Diamonds Network. One, for instance, Candy. I'm just so honored, Candy, to have you here in the Diamonds Network. And all the others, Dale and Sunny, Voices from the Alternative World, Cynthia's long call on Thursdays, her astrology, and I don't want to forget anybody. And Candy has a show, and then me and Candy have one together. But we have two others cooking in the background. One will come probably 2 or 3 weeks here from now. We're going to have a brand new show. Yes, the Diamonds Network is growing. And then there's another one in the works down the line in the near future. And I'm sure that's why I'm asking everybody that has a show that wants to start a show. You're in creative mode. These are the energies. You heard it from Cynthia and weeks before that. Come on and give me a call, and we'll see what we can do for the world, right? My number is 763-670-9120. Call me anytime. And I don't want to forget anybody. Let's see. I just want to thank all that are joining, and even in the background, we're building the website, the Diamonds Network website, and thank you, thank you, thank you, and thank all you that share the shows on Facebook, and just thank all of us. We thank each another. Big hug, you guys. All right, so that's all for my little show. Candy, come on in.
Well, hi, Elizabeth, and all your friends. Yes, this is Candy from the Candy Shop Show. Opening the candy jar treat to see what we've got for this evening. Yes, it's exciting that the comet is coming tonight and tomorrow night. People out on the East Coast of America were supposed to be able to see it about 5 p.m. this evening. It's going to be at the nearest. There's going to be two twin comets, and then, but as they're slowly going away, they might be very visible even with the naked eye or with binoculars on March 28th. The problem of seeing it tonight and tomorrow night when they're the very closest is that the moon is too full and too bright. So they've got animations, and gosh, Elizabeth was so fantastic. She set the intentions that this information would hit mainstream media, and I certainly saw it on NBC News last night at 5:30. So Elizabeth did a great job setting that intention. Well, we know that the Galactic said that we should be that part of them encouraging this comet to come now was to get people to get interested in the sky, get them to look up, and maybe they would be seeing some of their spaceships. And well, we talked a lot about that topic on a recent show. So, but just get all your friends interested in looking up at the sky. And when they're open to the suggestion that they watch for spaceships, you can throw that in as well. Well, we're not going to be talking about Benjamin so much right now. Last week, his full story didn't get up on YouTube that I could find until several days late. There's an awful lot going on, and I'm not surprised that it's late again this evening. A lot of interesting things happening behind the scenes. Well, I want to, you know, he talks about the Asian White Dragon Society that's trying to put in a great financial system for us and helping take steps that the Galactics has talked about as we move into a gold-backed currency and then a global currency like civilizations on other planets have, and then someday maybe we'll have the kind of financial system like they had on Star Trek. Well, I am wanting to share something about the situation in China. Perhaps some of my viewers heard today what was going around the internet about people being so upset about some of what's happening in China and economically. And I have a personal private insider's report that I thought I might share with you as well. But let's start with Rutger's story out of Beijing. And you see, later, maybe Chris and the Galactics will want to share some feedback on this. But the news story today was that General Motors is pressing ahead with its investment plans in China, the world's largest automaker. We're expect car demand to grow from 3 to 5% a year on the average until 2020. Now, of course, on the internet, when we got this message this morning, everybody was appalled at the conspiracy YouTube videos about the fact that, oh my God, we spent billions of dollars, billions, to bail out GM after the 2008 fiasco. And, you know, people are kind of upset. Not only did they pay the CEO so much, but, you know, it looks like a lot of money has gone to China. Anyway, that was the tone of the YouTube this morning. I'll go on with the news report. While GM continues to bet on the growth of the Chinese market, J.D. Power has said that 3 or more years of less than 5% growth will trigger a painful restructuring in China's auto sector. Analysts say China's auto market has entered a period of unprecedented uncertainty as the economy grows at its slowest pace in 25 years. Even though the China market is maturing, it will still be a tremendous source of growth for us in both the short term and the long term, GM President Dan Amen said during a media conference today, March 21st. China's chief, Matt San, who disclosed the car market growth estimates until 2020, said GM's plant there opened last year was operating at maximum, and a planned second phase is being added there so that they can produce 480,000 cars a year. He said that SUVs and luxury cars will continue to be hot segments in China going forward. GM will launch 60 new or refreshed vehicles in China in the next 5 years. Vehicle sales growth ground to a halt in mid-2015 as the economy's growth slowed and the stock market slumped, although car sales rebounded late in the year after the government cut taxes on small engines from October. Well, I want to share my private letter now because I have a friend who has been a longtime engineer in Michigan with GM, and he writes, Candy, this report is all true. GM, because I sent him my report about the horror that people have about, you know, all the investment in China, plus, you know, this story. GM has been investing in China to access the Chinese market, and yes, the communists enforce strict policies on companies that try to do business in China. That's what my report was upset about, the communist factor. First off, no Western company can do business in China by themselves. They must partner up with a Chinese company in some sort of joint venture, of which the Chinese part owns 51% or more. Next, the Western company must bring in its latest technology and share it with their Chinese partner. Next, all raw materials and labor must be local to China. And some of my friends listening know that my manufacturing business collapsed in 2002 because of the competition I was getting from China. But, you know, I ran my corporation for a decade, and I'm okay that I've moved on, but it didn't feel okay in 2002. Anyway, vehicles built can be sold inside China or exported. No vehicles can be imported. Isn't that something? They will not import vehicles. Also, Chinese suppliers must be used first, or an outside supplier must partner up with a local Chinese supplier, as stated above, to support a vehicle program. This obviously allows Chinese companies owned by communists to take the lion's share of the profits from selling into the Chinese market. Plus, it forces Western companies to educate and train Chinese companies on the latest technology for free, advancing them into the 21st century in one step. The vehicle I am working on designing right now is the CT6, which is being built in two factories, Detroit for the U.S. market and Shanghai for the Chinese market. Many people inside GM do not like this arrangement, but GM executives feel this deal with the devil is the only way to access the growing Chinese market, onto which GM is counting on to earn capital to offset the high UAW labor cost and the material cost of operating inside the U.S. And, of course, my friend being an executive at GM, you know, they're pretty upset about the UAW rules and things, you know, where they have to, the workers have to show up and be paid, even if they're just sitting in a room doing nothing, because it's more efficient for GM to have the robots do the work that the men used to do. And so the men sit in the room and they take naps and they get their high pay and then they leave and go to their other job. And so that of course bothers some people. But I know the story is all complicated. We all know it will not be long, Candy, before the Chinese renounce all current agreements and throw the Western companies out. Only Chinese companies will have access to the Chinese market. Plus, China will start exporting cars to the U.S. and Europe to compete with us. In fact, GM has announced its plans to build Buicks in China for export to the U.S. This was used as a leverage in the latest UAW contract talks. Well, there you have it, the inside story from Detroit. And I know that, you know, these people that are doing this are not really, you know, connected to the White Dragon Society and those that are trying to do wonderful things for the whole globe. But anyway, I hope some of my readers tonight found that interesting. And that's
Candy?
What I've got tonight. Yes.
Okay, tell me the whole point of what you brought that on. Just in your words.
The whole point of the story, is that what you said?
The whole point of why you brought it on tonight, yeah, in your own words.
Oh.
What made your heart led to do that?
Well, we're talking about the Asians so much, and we're talking about global things, and there's
so all that story,
in the election and like you know, we've been talking about Trump and why he's doing what he's doing, and he says he's going to bring more manufacturing back into America, and it's just all the lies that the cabal did. The cabal took $80 billion of our people's tax money and gave it to GM. And then GM has taken all that money and gone to China. And it's just making us poorer and poorer. You know,
yeah.
All the lies that people have found jobs since 2008 when they really haven't. And so things are getting desperate, and maybe people will be happier that the galactics are coming and will help our economy. Maybe people will be depressed enough about our economy that they're willing to risk it on the solutions that the galactics have.
Right, right. I was just curious why you brought it in. I challenged your heart. I wanted you to bring that. That was great dissertation. A couple things that come to my mind, and, you know, we're in the energies of creativity and all that, fantastic visions. One of the things is it's up on the YouTube, it's up on the blog. I blogged today, or was it yesterday, a man from Russia, and talking about the game of Monopoly. It's a couple good videos there. They're short. The game of Monopoly, and mentioned how many corporations there are in the world, which is all cabal controlled, and all of it trickles down, and it's all like an octopus all around the world. So that doesn't surprise me, the GM, the car thing, the China, the Russia, and all that, because that's still part of the matrix that's still, as we speak, crumbling. And then the other thought I had, Candy, I'm glad you brought this in. The other thought I had, because we're paradigm shifting, I am going to be so happy when we get out of this, and, you know, we've been programmed and taught in it. China, Russia, oh, USA, we're going to China. But you know what? There is no lines. We are all one, aren't we? There's no split-up nations. There's just one people on this earth, different colors and different uniquenesses. Wow. Candy, thanks for bringing that up, and that was good to know. And, yes, thank you so much. And it's funny, too, they're making a lot of cars. There's already tons of cars made nobody's using. There's pictures on the Internet I've seen more than once. All around the world, they purchased tons of land to put all these cars on. So hopefully, Candy, when all this goes to the other side, which it is because the chaos machine is down now, we're out of the transition, just beginning the other side of it, we're all going to get a brand-new car. There's so many cars made, and we'll probably have a new technology to attach on that car. Maybe it'll fly or levitate. What do you think of that?
Oh, yeah, we've got to start levitating and rip up some of these roads that are burning Mother Earth's skin. Yeah,
definitely. And then all the walls. This is a new thing. I was driving down the interstate today, and I was just thinking, all the walls, this is the wall thing. They build these tall walls along the interstate now because neighborhoods, and it's too noisy. And they build the fences. And I was thinking, Candy, you'll know what I'm talking about. You know, it goes from the federal down to the state to the counties. They get all kinds of money, and even voted in by the people, all kinds of money to do all these repairs, to put up the walls, put up the fences. And they only use probably 10% of the money to build that stuff, and the rest the cabal takes and uses for themselves. And, yeah, I know. I'm going to be glad when it all melts away, too. Yeah.
Well, I'm curious to see if Chris has something to say about this and other great new stuff, since the chaos machine is neutralized.
Absolutely. Well, thank you for your candy darn news, Candy. Thank you so much.
And everybody tune in my show Wednesday night. It's going to be a good one.
Don't forget the last Wednesday. That's what
Candy was alluding to on our news. That was really, 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 really good.
Absolutely. And then Elizabeth and I will be on Thursday night.
Okay, yes. Elizabeth and me and Candy on Thursday night. All right. Hey, Chris, are you here? Hey, Chris, are you here?
Yep, I'm right here.
Yep, there he is. How are you tonight?
I'm doing pretty good.
Go ahead.
What I was seeing, you know, when Candy was talking, there was just a jumble of images in my head, but I could hear, you know, muttering in the background of a couple beings going, there was one that was saying they don't know how much it's going to change, meaning these people know, but we don't. And I could hear a couple of them. A couple of them were laughing, but it was a good laugh. It wasn't like a sinister, like, it wasn't like
right.
that. It was like, some good things that were going to take place. Now, I know the future isn't set in stone, and the further we go into this new density, the less set in stone certain things are, and the more our thoughts will manifest the timeline.
Mm-hmm.
I've noticed that completely. And what's interesting about this is I had, you know, when I was, you know, after I got done with my read this afternoon, I started looking more into.
Can I interrupt you 1 second?
Yeah, go ahead.
Before you start in, I just want to make this, I mean, it came more clear to me after the chaos machine went down completely. There was onion layers peeled off in several of the Monday shows and Wednesday shows. So what became clear, and I asked Chris, and maybe you can add a little bit to it, what really happened is, you know, Franco Di Nicolo saying there's energy waves of 5D coming in. The last one, and I've said it several times on shows, the last one came in on, what was it?
March 14th is when the chaos
December 21st, 2016, and was in, no. But anyway, 5D, the last one came in 3 months before March, and it was be fully integrated in March sometime. Well, we found out the answer when it was fully integrated in, right, Chris?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah,
and
most definitely.
That was when the chaos machine, last week's Monday call, and, you know, that doesn't mean everybody's in 5D. That just means all the 5D energy is here. It's in the earth, and we're sucking it in as we go. But what that really means is, you know, the transition, we've gone through the transition. We're on the other side. We're in the very, very beginnings of the golden age in a tangible way, and even going to gain more. And you, anything you want to add to that?
Yes, definitely. What I was going to go into is there are several things I was going to
into. I'm sorry, one more thing, because I know we'll get lost in this. I wanted to tell you one thing. I was driving down the interstate, Chris, yesterday, two days ago. And in White Bear Lake, there's off the interstate, there's this huge snowman, you know, like a paper mache snowman. You see him with off the interstate. He's like the size of a small three-tier building, right?
Mm-hmm.
Huge. And the thought went, oh, man, I need to tell Chris, come here and bring Winston.
Yeah, I regret very much not filming him, you know, doing that with a snowman, because that was actually pretty funny.
Okay, before you lose the train, go ahead.
Okay. What, you know, I'd gotten an email from someone about, you know, she wants to remain anonymous, but I got an email, a couple of emails talking about the precession of the equinoxes and about, you know, missing time fragments and about the harvesters, all these things kind of thrown into one, Ra group, all of it, about how the Law of One books actually, some of it predicted some of the stuff we've actually spoken about. Now, this person knew that I had not read the Law of One books at all. And we're talking about the timelines merging. You know, George has come through a couple times talking about the timelines merging. A lot of other beings have. Syrians have. Pleiadians and all of them have. And even the Ra has. And then I found out the bit about, we were speaking about the alternate timelines that were negative, that were going to fall away, that some people think there's going to be this apocalyptic Earth when it really isn't. Apparently the Ra beat us all to that, and it just was not published, I came to find out, in the original Law of One series. The original channeler actually said it, but she misinterpreted it and didn't know enough about parallel universes and timelines and thought it was going to be a bunch of doom and gloom, and she left it out so it didn't spook anybody. But I, to get to back a little further on track, a Bendigoth came to me after I had watched this video that somebody I know, a good person named April, had left on my Facebook timeline about the similarities or the similarities between what happened on an episode of The Simpsons and this thing that Trump just did not too long ago. You know, Candy was talking a little bit about Trump in there, so I figured that was a good segue into this segment. First, I didn't think anything of it. I'm like, okay, I'm going to look at this.
Yeah,
and I didn't think it would trigger anything. Hmm?
Let me just tell everybody, in the video was a scene where Trump was going down an escalator staircase that looked like an airport or something, and he turned to the side, waved to the people, just put his hand up, right hand up, and then he put his left hand up and put a thumbs up. Well, in Simpsons show, Simpson is the same scene, cartoon Trump in front of Simpson. Simpson's riding the escalator down with him, and he did this. Trump did the same thing. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, yeah. And I, at first, I figured it was going to be like all the other, you know, Simpsons blurbs that I've seen over the years that have similarities, but I didn't think it was going to trigger anything, you know, psychically or mentally or anything like that. But, you know, as I kept watching, I got to thinking, okay, what other things have I seen? What have I seen that pertains to what we do and what I've seen over the past, even the recent past month? And I got to thinking, okay, in the series, the children never age, you know, and I figured that was this their running gag they had going. Well, I had a voice come to me and say, you know, my own intuition was saying this. It wasn't any of the Galactics. This was my own intuition that was saying, you realize that is a symbol of a grand illusion, do you not? And that was what my higher self said to me. It was a symbol of, things repeating over and over again, you know, like almost like with computer precision, people just going through the whole routine, everything in that is symbolic. Well, I didn't really think about it, and all of a sudden it started to trigger some of my own missing time. And it just started to go into this weird spiral, and then a Bendigoth had me read this email from a person on the email, and then he went, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to read what he said, and then I can go into the rest of what I was going to say. He went into the whole narrative about the harvesters, like what I put a video on my YouTube from a session I've had with a couple people, and this I was seeing, well, he confirmed it. He said, okay, I'll just go into it. Bendigoth here, my friend. Do you know why I had you read that prior to our session this evening? Tell me, please. Is it because what I am feeling now has direct bearing on these messages? And he says, correct. You see, when you watched the Simpsons video earlier and thusly realized that the fact that children not aging was roughly symbolic message about the effects of the grand illusion, it triggered the next stage of your abduction memories. Now, the only reason that I am allowing you to remember this part is that it has direct bearing, as you say, to the itching on the back of your head. Do you realize what is causing this sensation of both itching and pain? Do you not? Tell me, please. It is one of those square implants, is it not? And I've spoke of on several shows back of a square implant that's the back of some people's heads. It kind of resembles a cracker shape. And I asked if it was that. And he says, yes, I'm afraid so, dear one. Every human being within the confines of the grand illusion has one. Only fighting its negative impulses completely will free you of it. Now, please refrain from trying to remove it, your one aura. The bad harvesters will see and feel it quite strongly. Since these beings have essentially stolen essence and energy from everyone, they have effectively become humanity's shadow aspect, and as such, must be treated no differently than your very own emotions. All the while not, and I repeat, not taking on any nanites into your core. And I said, so are these being, are these Reaper beings kind of like wardens on the other side of the illusion barrier? He goes, correct. You're one, you are seeing things as they truly are. However, these beings, if you can call them that at all, can be very, very easily transformed, as you found out last week. However, I would strongly advise that you please leave them alone. They will not always hear you correctly, dear one, and thusly will perceive your attempt at communication as an attempt at escape. Then they would follow their core directive and act accordingly. Do you now see why we have told you to be very, very careful when dealing with them? Tell me, please. I said, yes, Abendigoth, I do see, but the memories still come and bleed to the surface. Yes, of course they do. This, however, can be a very, very good thing or a very, very bad thing. It just depends upon the person and their soul mission. And let me see. I'm going to check real quick information. Okay, I was just being told the information in the email I had received was accurate about the precession of the equinoxes. It was the 75,000-year period with 25,000-year segments of these beings came back to collect energy. And let me see here. Okay. Let me look really fast. All right. I had a strange memory come back as of today. This was partially, if people have watched my YouTube channel, there is a video on there that I have labeled The Harvesters and the Grand Illusion. It's a Watcher Speaks Sessions. And it talks about a ghost town that I've mentioned on this show once when Amanda was on the show, and I found that she had some hidden abduction memories regarding this ghost town. It looked like an Old West ghost town that looked almost kind of like a movie set in a way, that they'd filmed some Western or something. Well,
this ghost town is what you relate to as the backstage, right?
Mm-hmm, one of the places in the backstage.
Okay,
yes, yeah. It was just an old ghost town that had been absorbed to the other side of the illusion on the backstage area.
And this is the ghost town amongst others that will reappear as 5D energies get even stronger. Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. And so this came through. I remember standing next to someone. I cannot remember it clearly enough. This person was asking, when will it collapse, meaning the illusion? Because this person and I spotted these white orbs that were holding up the illusion barrier, almost, you could kind of say, like pillars. And I remember seeing these, and then I remember hearing the same, my higher self saying again, where have I seen these before? And before I answer that, I'm going to, I'm going to read this. We had found white glowing spheres locked into a timer. The harvesters respond to thought alone, but cannot all be brought down all at once. Or can it be done through some epic fight to the finish? There are many tiers to this false Tower of Babel. One of them is struggle. The other one is hate. Also, there is one that I forgot to mention, and that is prisoner. We are all free. We are all one. Give me just one second here. That's under my eye. All right. The harvesters and us must evolve together, or we will both be lost to history. This does not mean, however, that domination from them is excusable. No, quite the opposite, in fact. But as we, as a species, have been given a rare gift, a rare opportunity to evolve within a construct designed to hold us down, beat down, and keep us down both in a physical sense and an emotional one. We are strong. We will survive within and beyond the grand illusion. We are all one. This means all species everywhere, including the harvesters. Why should they die when we live? Why, I ask you now, upon the eve of this chance to look beyond the mirror and a chance to look beyond our very own reflection, at our very own reflection. This is what my higher self came up with earlier. Now I'm going to return back to those white orbs. I remember seeing this somewhere, and I couldn't quite put my finger on it until it just popped into my head. My higher self and my guide said, where have you seen this particular weird type of thing before? Was it on a TV show, maybe? And I'm thinking, okay. And then it dawned on me, there was a show on many years ago and a remake in the modern time called The Prisoner. And I remember that anytime somebody would escape, there would be a white ball or something that would come and capture them and throw them back into the prison. And the main character always ran into that throughout the series. Now, there were two different versions of this. One, the guy was on an island, I believe. And in the second version, the remake, played by an actor named Jim Caviezel, he's the one that played Jesus in The Passion of the Christ, it was all based in thought alone. And it was based on, you know, he was somebody in the modern world working in a humdrum job, and part of him existed in this prison with these white orbs that were in some kind of, it was even said to be an illusion. And then it dawned on me that both versions had an accuracy to it when I started writing that out earlier. And when I saw that thing with the white orbs, I'm like, okay, somebody got this from somewhere. And somebody was trying to give people a message about something. And when I went back to looking at these white orbs, it's like almost like their glow, the more it diminishes, the more the illusion barrier goes down. It's like they're like an egg timer. And that they're counting down to something. Now, I know these particular harvester beings were the ones that put this up, but what the guides were trying to get at, what Abendigoth was trying to get at, was these beings, since they've been around us for so very long, have become our shadow self, our shadow aspect, humanity's less than desirable aspects after a while. They became this, what we have to not necessarily embrace in a way that would harm us, not to harm everybody, not to surrender to ill will towards us, but surrender to more of the love aspect, more of the oneness aspect. These beings are barely sentient. They are essentially, they're not necessarily, I don't want to call them animals, that's the wrong choice of words, but they barely can speak language, from what I found out. That's why they react on instinct. And the more you go into the loving mindset, the oneness mindset, the more these machines beings' purpose, or these nano beings' purpose, or whatever they've become, changes. Their original programming that they instilled on themselves were to extract the loose energy. But if we don't provide it to them, they would have to choose something else. And they want to be able to become synergists with everything. Give them a reason to be able to do that on their own. This is what I was being described. The way that the illusion is set up is almost kind of like the Chinese finger trap, where you pull on it and you get stuck more and more. But if you enter what David Wilcock calls the rainbow body, or maybe the ascension process, or whatever words you have for it, it makes it easier, and therefore the illusion isn't as rough. And therefore these beings don't really have a reason to do what they do. And these implants that everybody has are essentially, they're inert. they don't really do too much unless somebody would leave the constructs of the illusion and go safe place like that ghost town, for instance. Because I have an abduction memory to where I encountered one of these beings in the desert. And they all they looked like was like a cloak and with a staff. And there's nothing in them. They're just hollow. And I just remember seeing one of these in a sandstorm. Now, earlier when we were talking about our visions, when you, Cynthia, were talking about our visions, what I did was I took one of these beings or one of these collections of these I'll just call them beings. And Gemma was standing there with me. And what I did is I projected light into this, and I hit him with the law of one symbol. And what I did was I transmuted it into a bunch of flying birds and butterflies and everything. And I did it to several of them. And then they came down to Earth and came within the illusion and started to weaken the remaining illusion barriers. And some of those orbs, those white orbs, began to get duller and duller, like the timing had been sped up on them. Like somebody had gotten what to do, a grouping of people had gotten truly what to do, and it weakened the illusion that much more. And so it's, like I said, it's the Chinese finger trap, to where you resist, you really, really resist it, and it just becomes strong. It's like negative emotions and negative impulses seem to strengthen it. So if you remain in the positive balance, now I know negative emotions are part of the balance. We all have them, we all have the low points. But as long as they're not the overbearing, you know, hateful, fearful, over-the-top, you know, type of emotions you'd find like in the Middle East or somewhere overseas in some war-torn area or something like that. As long as they're not anything like that, as long as it's balanced and that you are true to yourself and to what you are, regardless of what you're doing, that barrier will always become weakened. And that was the basis for the lock. Somebody somewhere along the line tinkered with it and made it less of an oppressive sort of thing and more of a teaching tool. I'm not sure who tinkered with it, but somebody tinkered with it to make sure that it was more of a funnel to funnel people towards the ascension process versus fighting and killing each other. And
wow.
I'm not quite sure who did it. You know, the Agarthans won't admit it. You know, none of the other groups will admit who did it. They just know who they say who created it, which was the Harvesters. But they won't say who tinkered with it. So it could have been any number of them.
So what you're saying is beings are all around us. And I think what Chris is saying is because we're paradigm shifting, and if you're paradigm shifting,
Elizabeth, you cut out there.
Oh. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, okay. I'm just saying what you're really talking about, there are all those beings there, and we all just, as we are conscious, we here listening, and apparently conscious of our awakening, we're paradigm shifting, and we're consciously taking the steps to paradigm shift within ourselves. So, you know, we're not all perfect. We can't think positive all the time or whatever, but you will be conscious of you hating somebody or thinking bad thoughts, and you, as your conscious awake, can and decide to, okay, I need to paradigm shift that. I need to think a different way. I need to react a different way because, you know, these programs of anger, unforgiveness, doubt, and stuff is changing. So as your conscious, we can do that. So that one of the things neutralizes beings, so that puts those beings on your side a little bit more, on your favor a little bit more. And you're saying there's somebody that tinkered with that so those beings can be on our favor as long as we're paradigm shifting into the, you know, the good emotions. Something like that. Is that right, Chris?
Yes, yeah. These beings, granted, they keep people were approaching a certain zenith or pinnacle in their evolution. But it looks like, I said, somebody screwed with the timer and screwed with the programming a little bit to where that it will funnel people towards an evolution versus an oppression.
And also, another thing that comes out of this, Chris, is, you know, the Gargalactics always say it's a process. It's not at all a work, right? In a way.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, it's
mouth dropping things.
Mm-hmm.
So that's intertwined in our back and our head, which is good. I mean, in those beings. So that's great.
Mm-hmm. Oh. And let me say, I know that somebody wanted to come through tonight. You know, he's been on the show before, quite a while back. Actually, he spoke about some of the waves coming through this system a while back. He calls himself Tipurman. He's one of the Xeon species, and he hasn't been on in quite a while. Mm. And he told me earlier that he wanted to come on tonight to talk about this more in depth. So that's who's going to be coming through here now.
Oh, perfect. Because I have some questions for him when he's done. You're done, sir.
Okay. Let me see if he's around. Okay, there he is. Yeah, he's a purple and black or in bluish orb. He's made of nothing but energy. So he's one of the few actual true energy species I've run into. So going to see, bring him through. Greetings. My name is Tepormon of the Xeon Energy Constructum. This particular subject that you have touched on, of the beings you know of as the harvesters, this one is quite accurate in his display of, as you say, reflection of these beings. They are and have become your own shadow aspects. They have taken on the undesirable, scary traits that you human beings have put out over the years. So it is important to remain balanced in the oneness. Do what you came here to do. Even if at times you are upset about things, that is normal to the human condition. This is part of the balance. Even holding back something, an emotion, like, say, sadness, is and can become something very negative and add to the darker spectrum of things when you do not intend to do so in the first place. This particular instance with these beings, they started out as, you say, corporeal form. Beings like the Elohim were around at the time of this happening. However, their details on this are quite fuzzy, since they were more around Earth than the original Harvester homeworld. But this I can reveal to you more than they have. We, the Xeon species, watched as a beautiful blue, purple, and yellow planet became the pinnacle of one of the Harvester colony worlds that now has fallen into ruin in a different system. This ruined world resembles the shape of what you would call a donut, but this originally was not how it looked. It was very much like your own world. However, on this world, there was a race of beings very similar to that of your, how shall we say, which race these are similar to. They are more or less like your natives are today, but with a much taller stature and a much longer set of limbs, as you say. These particular beings were not related in any way to the species you know of as the Anunnaki or that of the Syrian star beings. This particular race walked along their planet surface much longer ago than you humans have been alive, even in the missing time construct, as you say. These particular beings got it in their head one day to become transhuman, as you humans put it, or practice transhumanism by bonding with their machines, thinking that they would be able to transmit thoughts from one person to the next. This ended up taking on a life of its own, as you humans say, and they became a more degenerative species, given enough time. These people bonded with their technology so much they forgot how to speak. They forgot how to count. And in time, they forgot how to speak words, numbers, and they forgot how to see. And even more time passed. They forgot how to walk. They forgot how to feel the wind at their back. They forgot to feel the rain on their faces. They forgot to feel the sunlight bearing down on them. They degenerated into what you know of today as the black goo. They turned into this only after many centuries of this technological bounding. This happened over a period of 25,000 years on their world, where they were supposed to learn within the third density, but they turned into something that they were never meant to turn into. Let this be a lesson to people here on Earth who are mimicking that particular construct. How people just stare at their phones or stare at their computers from day to day and not interact with people on a regular basis. This is how it began on their world, and this is why it happens here. They are merely mimicking what took place there during what they call the harvest times. However, this original 25,000-year period was, as you say, a shame because they learned nothing and they degenerated into beings that could barely tell the difference between one being and the next. These particular nanites were not the other ones that are from the future time frame. These particular ones turned, like I said, into the goo. The ones in the future, however, were the ones that people see that look like eyeballs and faces and beings of that nature. However, this original set, when the time before the degeneration began, these beings became more or less like, as you say, blobs. These blobs often were able to walk for short distances. They started to only walk in shorter distances each passing moment. Then they just fell over. And then they refused to even eat food or drink water. Many died. However, in this particular instance, this is the image they portrayed in your own histories as the harbinger of death, the Grim Reaper, as you put it. This is originally where the idea came from. They saw the bony, decomposed constructs of their fallen and decided that this was an image that they would use to gain the energy they needed to continue existing. This is not acceptable, but in this instance, this one was correct by saying the way we save them is by saving ourselves, since they have become so codependent upon our energy matrices. This will ensure that they can evolve back to the stage that they were before they made the greatest mistake in their own history. They can one day be put back as they once were. Could they be accelerated? Yes, but then they would learn nothing. They can be put back exactly as they were before the technological binding began. This is a world unknown to most species, or if it is known, they hush about it and will never speak of it because they are afraid to incur its wrath, very much how people on your world do not wish to speak an ill, thinking that it will somehow manifest. However, speaking an ill does not necessarily always mean that it will manifest. Manifesting it within your thoughts, speaking it with your words, and really meaning it, then it manifests. This is a fear that these other beings have instilled in people, by which I mean when people say the word demon, for instance, they automatically recoil and go, oh my God, that's so horrible. But then in turn, they have just manifested something similar near their own energies. This cannot be. However, even though there are some people out there that are cautious and know certain details about, say, demons, draconians, and the like, they are saying that do not speak of it out of a place of fear, even though they see it out of a place of compassion, which is really what it is. However, this one minute place of fear is the key component in actually drawing these beings in to begin with. This activity must cease in order to bring about balance so that these harvesters will one day become the flesh and blood beings they once were. However, it will take many, many millennia of purging all the DNA of all the worlds that they have assimilated, so to speak, into this gooish, ghoulish figure. This is not how a being was meant to live. Think of this aspect when you just sit and stare or sit and look at your phones, even though these beings and the cabal have made it almost impossible for you to look away from it, from some of their past mind control techniques. Still, this is more of a, think of this as more of a resistance, more or less, like lifting a weight. Think of this as, say, when you feel lazy, do not do lazy things. Hence, what this one calls the lazy bug or the lazy gene. This was instilled as a bit of programming based on what the cabal came up with and what these harvesters and draconians came up with, so that people would be fat and lazy and not wish to look at anything but their television sets, their phones, and their computers. This does not negate business dealings, however. This is just fine so long as you walk around, get your bearings, as this one would say, and actually meet up with people and interact on an interpersonal basis. Sekhmet also spoke of this as a mistake they almost made on their world. However, they kept in the hard work aspect and ethic into everything. And instead of just doing everything from their homes, they go to work and they actually enjoy what they are doing. This is why the cabal added in the dread aspect to people's jobs, the dread aspect where you just do not want to go, but you feel you have to out of a sense of obligation. This is accurate, yes. This, we are not slamming or negating anyone that has to do this. This is commendable and will not be slammed. However, the dread aspect to it is not necessary. This is a pre-programmed condition by which these beings operated on so that people would be in a lower state of vibration and would extract the appropriate amount of energy they need in order to survive, or so they think. They feel that they will die without this sustenance, and they are not entirely false. However, if they would just switch back to what they once were prior to the integration of their technology, the transhumanism, as you put it, this would not be. They would not cease to be if they would just stop consuming and they would just start looking around them and observing everything and join the rest of us in the oneness. Though they have bonded with humanity and become their shadow aspect, this does not mean that they will automatically learn. We must learn and then teach them. This is what I came to say. Thank you.
That was profound. Wow. Thank you. And basically what they're saying, and you said a lot. One of the things I'll say you were saying is, you know, take our sovereignty back individually. I learned about a beetle this weekend. A beetle is like a caterpillar and a bug, and it grows and grows, and then finally it grows and grows and grows through turmoil and heals and gets better, and turmoil heals, gets better, consciously, we'll just say, okay? But then eventually it turns into a beetle, and the beetle is transformative and rich, and it's all healed. And then now the beetle is ready to go find a mate to be the same thing, all healed together and multiply. I don't know. I made a little story about that. Is that go with all what you said, Chris, and my dear fellow galactic?
Yes, you know, I feel that does, you know, a point of regeneration and growth, and that's what they're saying these beings need to do. They need to be in the oneness once again as they were prior to their ill transformation. Now, I knew part of this story to begin with. I didn't know the entire story. I didn't know that they that their world eventually turned into a technological donut like that. You know, I was expecting it to still be an Earth-like planet, but there was also another aspect of that planet that he was trying to touch on, too, that it wasn't translating correctly. I'll see if I can fill in there. On their world, also, there was a type of microbe there that came up out of their primordial soup, as it were. It was a very primordial world where these beings live. And it was almost like cavemen, if you want to call them that. And this microbe actually bonded with their technology and ended up creating what we know of as nanites.
Mm-hmm. See, so that's how things work.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and another point out of this is, look at here, guys. Little did we know, right? Now we're responsible for helping beings grow, and how, you know how we do it? We take a conscious responsibility and grow ourselves. Basically, the nutshell, love yourself unconditionally. You know, process, and through every day and every opportunity, you have lots of opportunities every day, right? So, wow, we have responsibility for these beings. And, yeah, this goes deep.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. So, since you know about energy, sir, I just want to reiterate, you know, regarding the chaos machine that came to Chris and his mom, and we started the onion layers and healed that with the law of one and through the last Mondays and last Wednesdays. And now the chaos machine is under the law of one. And from that, we learned on the Candy Show last week, if you guys haven't listened to it, that from the chaos machine being under the law of one, we learned that 5D energies then were able to fully integrate. My question first, and I have a few more of them, is if we didn't do that, would the 5D consciousness expanding energies still be having trouble to integrate fully? And that, I think that's why we did the chaos machine, isn't it?
Yes, that is correct. In the instance where the chaos machine was transformed into the egg of humanity, it allowed one way to end and another way to begin. It was an intermediary or a rung in the ladder, as this one would put it, in the mighty Jacob's ladder, so to speak, in the whole grand scheme of things, so to speak. This particular instance, the chaos machine was aptly named because it transformed that bridge that humanity needed in order to cross into the next threshold of 5D, as you put it. Now, this does not mean that the entire planet is in 5D density. This means that most of it is in 5 density, and possibly I would, if I had to guess at the amount of people in 5D at the moment, that would be roughly half of the Earth's population at this moment in time, though they are unaware of it. And these people are still fighting their own inner demons, as humanity would put it.
They're still resisting, yeah, and yes, not trying to take it in and trying to heal it. Yes, go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but these inner demons will rear their ugly head in other manifested forms. These manifested forms will take the shape of, as these harvesters have, possibly, but in the form of nightmarish fears that people mm-hmm. will dream about. This, however, will not be complete and not be, as you say, tangible for very long. The length of these particular nightmare sequences will depend on the person's resolve to get through this particular instance. So this instance this instance will be of one of several things, one of which is abduction memories coming to the surface. These abduction memories are unfortunately crucial to the evolutionary process, though some of them people must deal with because they are negative. This is an unfortunate truth to the matter. Bringing out these memories too quickly could result in a total collapse of the human brain synapses. However, if it is done slowly enough through the dream states, this will ensure that integration is successful. This, unfortunately, was done by the ones you call the Greys. But in their infinite non-wisdom, they thought that their methods were infallible. But what they did not understand is what the harvesters took from them, they transposed to us. And this, and they transposed that to humanity. What I mean by us is that the Sion species, we call ourselves the purveyors of the illusion, of the grand illusion. This also means information. This also means we help people evolve, as I am doing this evening. This information that I give you is crucial to understanding these abduction memories. They may seem like they come through out of sequence and very, very severe. This is part of the design by which your brain functions within the dualistic seed, as this one puts it, or this density. In 5 density, these symptoms will only get worse if you fight them through fear or fight them through some sense of suppression or some other nonsensical or less intelligent, as it were, thought train. I am not saying this out of an egotistical mindset. I am saying this out of a compassionate one. We, the purveyors of the illusion, do not wish to see humanity suffer within the nightmares of what has occurred inside and outside the grand illusion. So, in this instance, we offer our hand in extending these memories out into a more broader construct. What I am trying to say is these memories can come back in a more constructive manner. Though you will see that you have lived many, many, many times over within these memories. As this one says, you have lived longer than you thought you'd have. This one, as he has said, is in his 200s, as are a lot of people. That means there is a lot of missing time. The brain has to reintegrate. The amalgam of these memories cannot come all at once, or there will be a terrible price to pay. The synapses of the brain, human brain, cannot handle the very technology used to remove these memories. The technology is far advanced and was meant for someone far, far older and far, far more evolved genetically and mentally to use. This means the human brain may or may not get all of these memories back completely in one lifetime. This means that some of people may have holes in their memory, and sometimes this can be justly so, because there are some bad things that, if remembered, may not be able to be forgotten. This is an unfortunate side effect, as it were, but in the new density, positive and balanced thinking is the best, even if some things have to be pushed to the wayside. But things that were too horrible to mention in this call. But if that person is meant to get these memories back, like, say, a lost child or as you say, lost love or lost family, this is something that they are always meant to deal with and to help others deal with it in this time of energy changeover into 5D. This is an unfortunate but also fortunate aspect to the balance. People will go through mental hardships, but it is not at as big a cost as people would think. These things happened to them so that they, in turn, could help others. Take, for example, people that have been abducted by aliens and ridiculed their whole life for even mentioning it. This is not an accident. This person was forged in fire, as this one puts it, so that they could teach others how not to be, and also how to bring about these memories and share these experiences with each other so that other people do not believe that they are the crazy ones they thought they once were. This is an answer to all the questions. Thank you.
Wow. And like for a memory that comes back, like your mom abused you when you were a little kid, if that memory comes back, there, you're awake now, you're conscious of it. Don't run away, don't turn away from that memory. Take that memory in and do the work with it. Forgive it, love it, forgive your mom, forgive yourself, and call in the Galactics to have you help and pray the law of one over it. I'm finding a lot of those memories in me. I'll think of that memory again later on, and it's just like neutral. It's like blah. There's no emotion. It's just like an observer stage. So what you're saying is with this 5D consciousness expanding energy, if you're having a rough time and you're resisting it in any kind of situation, mental, physical, emotional, spiritual, and you're resisting it, meaning turning away from it, don't even want to look at it, and not maybe even trying to heal it in yourself if you're conscious of it, and maybe ones can't heal themselves because they're not even conscious that they can do this work, that they're awake, they just don't know they're awake, then that's when the dreams come, and it just keeps, the dreams and the nightmares are actually a mercy and grace for us all because there's healing in that, in the rather than doing it in this awake world. So what you're saying is it's going to be harder for other people that are going to resist and resist, and if you keep resisting, that's okay because it'll just get hotter and hotter like a hot potato for you, and then finally it'll get your attention, and you'll say, I'm not talking about us, but others out there, you know, what can I do about this? Or they'll ask, they'll pray, they'll ask, hey, I need help, God, or something, and it'll come. So I just wanted to put that in summary. Is that all of what you were saying? I want to make sure.
Yes, that is essentially correct. These people will be helped by us.
Yes.
Because they have since requested it on that particular level. But we as energy beings can only operate within the realm of dreams. So we can bring these memories forward along with the 5D energies, since humans
yes.
are so close to that threshold.
Like I said, dreams are actually a mercy and grace help for us, especially through this time period. So... okay, because my thought was, all right, there was something then we didn't know. Thank God for Chris and his mom and you guys, Galactics, come and deliver the letter to them about the chaos machine. So if we didn't do that chaos machine, set it at the law of one, we wouldn't be still fully integrated yet today unless somebody else came up with the plan. Is that true?
That is quite correct. Everyone was in their places, as it were, on the grand stage, which is your density and your life. Everyone was at the places they were supposed to be when all these things occurred. This is no accident. As people say, the phrase, a purpose, a lifetime, a season, everything happens for a reason. This is most true within this particular instance with the chaos machine.
So we must have planned this collective consciously, all together. We planned this scene with the chaos machine, collective consciously, unconscious, in the ethers, or whatever you want to say. And then we played it out in the last 3 or 4 weeks. That was beautiful. But that wasn't planned before that. I mean, it just came up, right? Was it early or was it just on time? And we must have planned that, right?
Everything that you know of within your history is always on time.
And it's planned, and it can go any way. Because what I'm trying to get at is to show everybody and me that we're planning moment by moment, day by day, week by week, how this is all going to turn out. It's going to be good, but just, you know, there's millions and millions, limitless ways how we could go about it.
Yes, of course, there are trillions of decisions at your disposal, but most of which are unknown to you at this time. The term that you humans like to use, set in stone, is no longer applicable within the constructs of 5D. However, your thoughts can be set in stone and create a stone-like feature to the new history. This is a phrase that has been misused quite a bit in recent years. People seem to think that the future that they see is always set in stone, even though it could be a possible negative future, such as a civil war or galactic battle of some sort. This is not true. However, there are different possibilities out there that could spark certain conflicts and certain intergalactic spats, as you humans say. But in this instance, I am saying within these new energies, these particular battles that people are attempting to manifest will only work if you truly believe them. In this instance, though, these new energies and these new timelines only reflect that of balanced energies. Those other timelines that people see where there is doom and gloom and apocalyptic battles of unending suffering are no longer applicable within this timeline in which you exist.
Okay, and then you talked about, if you want to know all the details, Candy's show on Wednesday, last Wednesday, and the Monday show last Monday. They talked about the 5D energies soon. Things within the barrier will become, that are hidden, will become visible. One of them is like that ghost town. The other one is like, I think, the Bermuda Triangle. What are some other things? And will we see anything in the sky? How soon?
Of course, you will see funny things in the sky, which you already have. My own people, the Sion corroboration, has been seen within the skies quite frequently. We glow as multicolored orbs the size of what you humans would call a basketball or medicine ball. We have appeared on many occasions above people's homes. We have appeared in the skies around the place you call Phoenix, Arizona. We have surrounded spaceships so that people can see them. We are the ones known as the Phoenix Lights in some circles. We have surrounded spaceships and aligned with their geometry, even though they are invisible. We show this to the people to show that they are not alone, and in the skies above them there is a lot of activity going on, but our message had to be subtle, but also not so subtle. In one action, we were able to show there was a triangular spaceship above the residence of Phoenix, Arizona. In one move, we were able to show this. We have not said anything. We did not verbalize it. We said it in one action, which proves in one action your skies could become full of, as you say, extraterrestrials. This has always been true. We are not the only things and the only species filling your skies. Certain chemtrails, as you call them, have been hiding the aspects of what goes on in your skies above them.
Ah, that's a good question. I'm sorry. That was very prominent. Chemtrails are neutral to me. But I say that the chemtrails have been very, very, very important. And they do it at certain times. So they got to be trying to hide something more. So go ahead. Thank you so much for my answer question. I didn't even ask it.
This particular instance, yes, though we have always said, and plus the Garthans have always said, and other beings have always said, not to turn these chemtrails into horrors that they do not need to be, which will harm others. However, the one thing we will point out is it is not only a method of communication that some of the harvesters and cabal people use, it is also a tracking system to track things on the ground where people do bilocation, astral projection, and psychic activities. However, there is another aspect to these chemtrails that is not just the aluminum fibers that people know them as. These particular trails in geometric formations are actually spelling out words in your skies. We are manipulating these particular streams to show certain emblems in the skies, while still maintaining the aspects of the grand illusion. we can still do subtle things just like the Phoenix Lights. However, above these chemtrails, there are many ships that sit up there. They are being masked by all of these thousands and thousands of trails that you see in your skies all of the time. Not all of these trails carry nanites, as many people have been led to believe. Some do, some do not. Some carry viruses, some do not. These very trails are what caused your rain to rain blood red in land you call India many years ago. This is also a method by which my people are helping people gain an immunity, not only physically, but mentally. This is something where people have paid attention to it so very much that not only have people given it power to some extent, they are also prepared to look up at the skies, just like Simeon and them said last week.
That's beautiful. Yeah, I give the chemtrails neutrality and love. No thought of negativity towards them. But I just had that profound thing last week, is they got to be covering up more than whatever they're doing. Anyway, thank you for answering that. That is profound. And just that question and all those sample examples you gave is actually disclosure. So if those things are going around on a law around the world this year, 5D and into next year, things are showing up, things in the sky, you know, probably more than is now, and not all boom all at once, and a little bit more in a month, a little bit more in a month. Somewhere in between there, we should start seeing things on Facebook and people talking about it. And, I mean, that's disclosure. And it goes to mainstream media because they can't hide it no more. They got to say something, even if they lie. I mean, that's disclosure too, right? And sounds like we're ramping up that disclosure thing.
Oh, yes, most definitely. Your full disclosure is already taking place. Like what we said about the chemtrails and what we said about all the things going in your world, on your world around you. These things are in plain sight, yet there are some people that do not notice that there are also some people that aim negativity at things like, we have said, chemtrails. But think of them, not necessarily in that negative like you have just stated, but think of them as your full disclosure. Think of them as somebody trying to paint a message in the sky to you that something other than what you have believed all of your life is going on. This does not mean that you throw a negative connotation at it, such as, look how horrible this is, but say, look how wonderful this is, that we are being given a blatant message of how much is truly going on in the world.
Absolutely, and as the people that are new and they see that and then they learn about the chemtrails, the negative stuff, then they'll, like, for example, one will be so worried about it and jaw-dropping, go to bed one night, pray, and ask God, oh, my God, God, what is that? You got to teach me, right? And then the universe will lead them, gravitate them the next day. They find a Diamonds YouTube show or whatever, and then they'll have their answers there from the chemtrail. Meanwhile, we have people first waking up, and they're thinking that negative because they're first learning about it and what there are, the GMOs and all that. But meanwhile, as never before, we have a bigger group that's awake, like us, and intending positive and good and not resisting things and healing to combat their, you know, to combat, to love their energy that they're putting out because they're just awakening, they're innocent, they don't know. What a beautiful flower of life. And disclosure goes on, many different aspects of disclosure. Right?
Yes, most definitely. This full disclosure, it begins when people open up their hearts and their minds to the possibility that they are not only not alone in the universe, but that their universe is much larger and much more vibrant than they ever thought possible.
Beautiful. Thank you so much.
You are most welcome. Thank you.
Namaste. How you doing, Chris? Wow.
Okay,
that was
it looks like Tiporman is detached from me there. He had a lot to say this evening. So
that was beautiful. Yes. Okay. Well, let me see if we have any questions, comments about anything that went on tonight. In should we do that?
Yes, we can do that. Yeah.
Real quick. Okay. Okay, anybody have any questions, comments, anything they want to bring in? Just star six. Wow, this is kind of another follow-up for what's been going on the last 4 weeks, and this was great. I like that. And encouraging and just right with the energies.
Just amazing, and great follow-up to my show from Wednesday about the harvesters.
Yeah, beautiful.
I have a question if no one else has one right now.
I have a question, but I can ask afterwards.
Okay, go ahead, Candy, and then Miss Kelsey.
Okay, this, what you said earlier, was, I mean, everything was so important, but a few people haven't called in until later in the show, and I thought it might be good if you could repeat or summarize in your own words, particularly those of us like myself who have read most of the five A Law of One books and what David Wilcox quotes from them all the time. What is it that you were saying that the Raw told Carla and Jim McCarty and they decided not to publish?
Well, I had gotten an email from someone who pointed out that David Wilcock had said on one of his wisdom teaching episodes that one of the channelers had omitted some material because it seemed they thought it was too negative to put in, and which that goes back to the point I was making: don't omit something, don't leave something out because it's too hard to look at. You have to face it and interpret it correctly and then deal with it and move on. This person did not do this. They didn't add the thing in there about the apocalyptic timelines that they were seeing, and they didn't know that there was going to be a timeline split of all the negativity to where it would be shed. They misinterpreted that, so they didn't put it in the books.
I see, and it almost seemed like it conflicted more with Casey and some of the other channelers who were talking about the apocalyptic time.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I believe that was the point that David was trying to make. I have not seen the episode yet, but this person pointed this out to me in an email and wanted clarification on that, and it matched perfectly to what we have been talking about here, to where these times are shed. Yes.
So these these end-time horrible events, have they already happened on the other timeline? Are they still going to happen? Do you know about that?
I don't believe so for the most part. I believe there are some timelines where certain things have to occur because of the balance involved. But I believe that, as what was said during the whole chaos machine, where they were talking about the avoidance of what was called Ragnarok, that was the Viking end of the world or apocalypse. I believe what that was, the people were seeing were a mixture between past, present, and futures. There were so many seers over the course of history that saw these things. They were seeing other timelines. Well, I think some of these things have already occurred. Some of them are going on, but in a parallel universe, and some of them may happen in a parallel universe because it's necessary for the balance to have it happen.
Everything's going to be candy. It's all in how each person perceives every little moment of their life, and that's really true. Oh, before I forget, Chris, I wonder, they said the chemtrails cover up people translocating, transporting, and stuff like that? So what they
well,
said?
Although the cabal sometimes will use them as like a locating a device. I have seen, after I've done some major channeling before, like when I took out the helped take out the Helg prison, for instance, I went outside and saw a lot of X's in the sky in chemtrail form, and my guides then told me that they were trying to find the location by which the signal that I was emitting was coming from, but they couldn't do it because we're protected.
Uh-huh. Candy, was there something else? Otherwise, we'll go to Miss California. Go ahead, hon. Candy.
Yes, go on. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Candy. Triad.
hi, this is Joanna.
Hi, Joanna.
Hi,
I've been thinking about you.
Oh, Thank you.
I'm glad you said hi tonight. Go ahead.
Yeah, I actually thought maybe I could help clarify some of the confusion with the apocalypse and different things.
Okay.
So in general, if you look at this learning period we've been in and we're at the final stage, then in general, at the end, everyone has an opportunity, let's say, to meet with the source independently to figure out where you are and where you want to be. And pretty much everything is honored. What happens then is you have to think of the splits happening in three different ways. You are going to have those people that were very negative that need to go along the karmic retribution, let's call it, path, the apocalyptic path. Those people aren't going to be here. Those people are going to experience, but it's going to be the opposite. You have to remember that history was written by the victors. They wrote the history for people to believe things because they thought that they were the ones that were going to be ascending and the rest of us were going to be left here to suffer because they were the victors and they wrote the history. But that's not actually what is going to happen. They're probably no more than 10% of the population, and they are going to go to a place and be taken at a moment in time, and they are going to be the ones that are left, and it's going to be like all of us were poofed to heaven, and then they start their journey back. There's going to be a group that it says they're not ready to graduate, and that graduating group is going to be allowed to continue in a third density environment, not as severe as it's been, but that's what they want. They want to continue learning about themselves and about who they are and who they are not based in the concepts of not as bad duality. Then there's the group that is done with this learning phase and wants to move in to the environment of understanding more about unity and love. So you've got to understand that the creator, the source, is not cruel in any way. So the manner in which it's going to be done for the people that are going to be staying in third or people that are going to be moving on, it's not going to be done in any way that in any way, shape, or form is cruel, unjust, mean. Can you imagine if the source met with all of your family members? Do you really know who's going to move on? Do you really know who's choosing that they want to stay? You may be able to point out some people that you're pretty sure, that are probably going down the karmic path, but do you really know? It's an individual choice. And so nothing's going to be done in a cruel way. There'll be a moment in time when the source is ready that basically out of the galactic central sun, there will be a very strong burst of energy, and the split's going to occur. The people that are staying on 3D or the people that are ascending, they're going to have all of the people around them that they normally do. It's just that some of them really may be more holographic. And so if someone's going to ascend, but maybe their sibling didn't choose to, they're going to still be there with them until their death. It's just they're going to be more holographic. They may even appear to be nicer. And it's the natural death cycle that will have them move on. The people that are staying in 3D, the people moving on, nothing cruel is going to happen to them. Nothing mean. It doesn't make sense that someone who is choosing to even stay in 3D would all of a sudden be missing half their family members. The source would not do that. That's cruel. So it's not going to happen this way. So people in 3D and moving forward aren't necessarily going to notice much, except there is going to become a point in time that people that are on the ascension pathway are going to start to notice things that weren't there before are starting to appear in front of them, these different places, these different whatever. And that is a clue down the road that, aha, I'm on that pathway. but it's not going to be that dramatic for those two groups, just for the first one.
Yes, that makes sense. That I couldn't have said that better myself. There's a lot of information there. This is exactly what the Galactics were getting at here, where of the timeline split. They've said something similar before, but you've said it in much more detail than a little bit more down-to-earth English than some of the Galactics have said it.
Right. Right, and then what Joanne said, you know, this is part of why Diamond's Network energy is out there. We'll just say the cabal, the 10% in the world, right? We wish, like Jesus, God says he wishes no one to perish. They're not going to perish. They're going to go finish their experience, what they want to do. But there may be, we're like squeezing out every little inch. Let's give them more chances, more chances, and more chances. And that's kind of what we kind of been doing, trying to do through the Diamonds Network energy with the Law of One and the Cabal members and all that. Some have went to the other side and wakened, and some haven't. I'm sure, I don't know, but God wishes no one. And yes, Joanne, I'm with you 100%. And that's what love does, unconditional love. Squeezes out as much potential of every single person as they can, because we know what it's like to be oppressed, and they're oppressed in their own way. We wish them, but anyway, yeah, it's like my last name, Mulligan, an extra shot in golf. Great, Joanne. Yeah.
Remember really that some of those beings that are now going to have to choose the karmic path were actually very high-level beings that chose to go back down the ladder to actually, now they got corrupted more, but you're not dealing with low-level people. You're dealing with people who said, you know what, I'm going to go down, I'm going to cause all this, and I know I'm going to have to do karma at the end. And I'm going to have to climb the ladder, I'm going to go even lower, and I'm going to climb the ladder all the way back up again.
So, and how do we know we didn't contract with some of those high-master beings that decided to go in the dark? How do we know we didn't contract with them? Like, okay, we'll make this Diamonds Network thing up, and we're going to pray in with the Law of One so you can skip that part, because you're being so cool going down to be these beings to help us. You know what I mean? It just gets multifaceted and multifaceted, doesn't it, Joanne?
It does, which is why really, you know, things that are being said over and over again is try hard not to put judgment on something, not to label something bad or good, because you actually don't have the perspective to really know that. And sometimes things that are bad, you know, are actually...
The light workers put judgment on the people that don't know, or vice versa. So what you do is, like, we're at this level, we're masters. So now at this level, what we can do is be sensitive and just kind of go down to their level and talk with them, kind of to lift them up.
Let me give you something to think about, because like I said, you can have all kinds of people around you, and there isn't a wrong decision to say that I choose that I want to remain in 3D for a while longer. There's no wrong decision.
Right.
So it's you know, we're talking 325,000 year cycle. You've had many lives in each one of those. What you know, you could have people that you actually think are in your life right now, and they're your rub. You're like, there's no way they can be ascending. But in the karmic balance of things, maybe they had all these benevolent lives, and this is their one life right here at the end that they got to be a jerk. They're ascending. You don't know. It's the balance of all of this time, and there may be plenty of people that you really think there's no way, and they're like, oh yeah, way, you know what I mean? They put it off to me. They didn't want to do some of the stuff that they have to do to balance themselves out, but they're doing
right.
And they're going ahead just like, you know, we're going ahead, you know. So you shouldn't, you really need to try to have a larger understanding of what's going on. And then understand that, you know,
an expanded consciousness understanding, a 5D expanded consciousness understanding, right?
Yeah. And then, but then you need to also understand that it's not, I don't believe it's this network's role to only be trying to deal with the people that are that are going to be going to that ascension path.
No. Yeah.
There are plenty of people that are going to stay in 3D, and the goal is there's nothing wrong with on this network helping people understand the concepts of learning about how do you process duality. And I think a lot of what has been being said to the people on this call by a lot of people are, you have to actually honor both sides of the spectrum, both sides of the sword, the negative feelings as well as the positive. You can't ignore them. You must experience them. You get to
not
point,
resist them. Don't resist them.
And you have to think of it as a pendulum swing. You know, if you can feel great sorrow, then you can feel great joy. If you don't hardly feel any sorrow, you do not hardly feel any joy. It's the pendulum effect. And so people want to avoid these really hard emotional things, thinking that it's wrong, when actually what it means is that if you're allowing it in, it means you're also allowing in the greatest of joy. So you and
absolutely. And it helps us grow with those people. It helps us grow. And what you're saying, all good thoughts, what you're saying in a nutshell to me is practice unconditional love in every aspect of your life and everybody that comes into your life. And it's okay, the old paradigm would be somebody comes in, oh, I don't like their energy. Oh, my God, blah, 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 blah. Get them out of here. Cut them off. No. That's doing the same thing as the old paradigm. We don't cut people off. We love them.
I think what I'm trying to say is that you should emotionally feel it all, and then you should, what will end up happening is that once you allow yourself to emotionally feel it all, you will eventually...
Okay, somebody's unmuted and laughing.
You will eventually learn to be able to process those things quickly, and you then will naturally come to the point of unconditional love and being able to accept it and move on. But you first have to allow yourself to feel the totality of the emotional swing to get to that point first.
Yes.
And so it's not going to be unconditional love first. It's going to be experienced
for
emotions.
Yourself. Yeah.
Feel them completely, understand them, and then you will start to feel the unconditional love.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And I think, thanks, Joanne. Nice to hear from you. Thinking about you, heard from you tonight. Now I don't have to worry. But I wasn't worrying. I was just saying, oh. Okay. Miss California, you're there, aren't you, still?
Yeah. So I have a question, Chris, about the topic you were discussing. I hear from other sites that some of our recall memories, let's say, are actually not physically our experiences. Like I'm not saying that the experiments and all those things didn't happen. They did, from what I hear. Although I don't have any recall memory in specifically in terms of those, but I do hear that some of it are inserted memories. They're not necessarily physically being tested on or whatever, but they come to us as a memory in terms of being a physical thing, but they're inserted memories. They're not actual memories. Can you expand on that? Is there a truth on that? And how, if we do meet those memories in our dreams, how do we handle those?
Well, what I do is, and yes, there are two different types. There's the actual abduction memories come out, and then there are the inserted false memories. And those will come out as well, but then those will just kind of dissipate. They'll just kind of, and some people will come out in an eruption of memory, like what they did with me. Some things came out. The heart, they would come out through, you know, like an eruption of emotion or... And I call it an eruption, but it comes out sometimes all at once, sometimes through dreams. But they will come out one way or another, because this new energy is making it so that the brain is a little more, I want to say, pliable, and they will make their way out and make their presence known. Now the false memories, they the way you can tell them apart from the other ones is they'll just feel hollow. You just know that even if it's a pleasant looking thing, you know, it's, you just kind of intuitively know that it is covering something else that you have to look at. Like, I noticed that in most people's false memories, I'm always seeing a scene of a beach with a sunset. I see it with every single abduction case. There's always an adult leading a child or someone across a sunset beach, and it looks like a real pleasant place, but then it fades into what the memory actually is. Mm-hmm. And I don't mean people should focus on that negative portion, but I'm just saying that this goes back to something, you have to deal with something when it comes along. And I'm not saying, you know, be cold or be too logical or be, you know, unemotional or anything like that. I'm just saying, you know, deal with the emotions as they come, you know, keep them in an unsuppressed state, you know, shed the false memories when they appear, and everything will balance itself out over a period of time.
So this shedding happens after you wake up and remember in the morning, mm-hmm, what you saw.
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. In some cases, like as you wake up, they'll just disappear. Yeah.
So in one case, I saw one time in a dream that I was sitting and there was another woman sitting in a room. It was around there, and there was a man who was actually pretty large, and I could see his face. And I asked him in my dream, what is your name? And he said his name is Warden. And when I woke up in the morning, that's all I remembered. But then later on, I'm hearing there's a planet called Warden. And then I heard today something from you, or maybe it was another day, that there is a warden outside of the illusion that they're keeping people. So I'm like, I don't know what to make out of that, honestly. And I don't know what emotion that's supposed to rise in me, so in order for me to deal with that, because I have no emotion. I just felt, here's somebody talking to me when I woke up in the morning, and I'm confused in terms of what was that. So that, to me, I'm not sure if that's considered a false memory or is it a considered actual memory outside of the illusion. How would you rate that?
Well, I would rate it all of the above, because I feel you had an actual communication with an actual being. Now, whether that being's intentions were pure or not, you know, he called himself, he probably said a warden, you know, or a warden of some sort. I've run into people that call themselves wardens, and very much like those reaver-like beings that were on the other side of the illusion. You know, Bendikoff called them wardens too. When I dealt with the Hell prison, I found beings that were in blue armor that called themselves the wardens of the prison. So this particular being, I feel he was a warden of... it feels like he's a warden of the dreamscape. Now, that might not necessarily be a bad thing. The feeling I'm getting from this guy is more of a neutral standpoint. I just keep getting this neutral standpoint from this guy. I keep seeing a uniform and everything, almost like he's in a job position and he's doing a job, and that was his job title. That's kind of what I'm picking up from him.
Oh, so you're referring to the person I saw in my dream?
Yes, the big guy. Yes,
oh,
I feel
he's He's at a job and in another dimension or another outside of the illusion, right?
Mm-hmm.
That kind
yes.
of a job, not in 3D. Okay.
Yeah, he's
that's
doing. He's in a different density. He's doing. He's in a job position. That's what I pick up from him. I don't see him. I don't feel him around. I just am picking up on bits and pieces of him.
Okay. Great. All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss California. Anybody else with a question or comment? I think we're pretty much well, awesome information tonight we all had. Chris, thank you so much, and Cynthia and Candy and Joanne, everybody that came on, Miss California. Mim, she's not on recording, though. All right, well, I guess
Elizabeth?
We're done. Yes.
Hey. It's Heather.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. I wanted to share a couple of things with you that I think you'll be excited about.
Okay.
Recently, my daughter, I've been doing things, and she's like, I dreamed you just did that. Last night I dreamed that was going to happen. Last night I dreamed that's what you were going to say.
What's that? So, that's synchronicity, or what is that, Chris? What's your thoughts on that?
Oh, I believe that since all time frames are connected and all events and possible events are connected, I believe that she is seeing elements of the immediate future. Yes.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm.
And
what
then
else?
Chris, he talked about the I know what they're called, chemtrails, across the sky.
See, you're becoming so neutral, you're forgetting the name of them.
Yeah, and they look like X's. Well, a couple weeks ago, I guess it was around, it would be my nephew's birthdays, I was headed up towards one of the cities here, and it was all a big tic-tac-toe board of chemtrails, like a huge tic. Like, he said something about X's, and
XOXO.
Right, I saw a couple weeks ago a big tattoo board across the sky. It was huge.
That's beautiful. XOXO is a code breaker, you know.
Right.
Love.
Now,
love conquers all.
O's. We got some O's going on, and we're good.
Mm-hmm.
And then the explanation from Joanna about the ball of one and how they left pieces out and how we were going to do it in different parts was very easy to listen to. Like they said to her about talking to the average Joe at one time. She is the Joe and the Joanna that makes it easy.
Oh, that's cool. Did you hear that, Joanna? That's nice, Heather.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So.
Wow. Talking to the average Joe, that's me, Joanna, from the Dimes Network. Just kidding. Wow.
And then it was my laugh that interrupted. I'm sorry, I had it unmuted earlier.
Oh, that's okay. Nice to hear you, too. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Thank you.
Keeping shining brighter and brighter every day, like that diamond you are.
Absolutely.
We're in the Diamond Club.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. You guys have a beautiful evening.
You too.
You
too. Thank you. Anybody else want to share, like Heather did? Any experiences you've had or insights? Anything you heard tonight or anything? Anybody get engaged, get married? Have a party. Yeah, like the Galactic said tonight, Chris, it's time to get out and socialize again, huh? That's encouraging.
Exactly. That was as much of a message for me as it was for everybody else. So.
I was thinking of you, too. I said, Chris. Yeah, really. I said, give Chris a nod there, too, while you're talking. Exactly what I thought, Chris. That's funny you brought that up.
Chris and all the 30-somethings.
Yeah, exactly. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, everybody look forward to tomorrow. Voices from the Alternative World with Sunny and Dale. And Wednesday, Candy Shop Show. Thursday, me and Candy's show. And, Chris, I can't send this to you till tomorrow after 12 noon. Is that okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So look for it then. In the meantime, everybody, keep shining like the diamonds you are. Sparkle bright. Good night.
you looking for healing or a change in your life to help you enjoy it more fully? You might benefit from a galactic energy reading and clearing from Chris Jacobs. Chris will work with you on a soul level to clear unseen negative influences, implants, programs, contracts, and energetic blocks. Chris Jacobs is a gifted energy healer. Contact him today at ChristopherStephenJacobs@gmail.com.